Hey, what's up, SBC Next Gen? Pastor Warren here, the campus pastor for our Stonecrest campus. And hey, y'all, we are excited to have y'all back again for our virtual children and youth worship service. This one specifically, our SBC Next Gen age group, 6th grade all the way through 12th grade. And regardless of how you got here this morning, maybe you barely up watching this service right now because you were asleep and your parents had to wake you up like, girl, boy, get your butt up and watch service. And then you fell back asleep and they bust back up in the room again. I said, get your butt up and watch service. I ain't gonna tell you again. Or maybe you just woke up and like, I'm gonna just tune in today, right? But regardless of why you're here or how you got here or how you're watching, we are excited to have you here right now. We are in a sermon series titled,
Way Up, I Feel Blessed. Way up, I feel blessed.
Straight up.
I'm way up, I feel blessed.
Today's message is too blessed to look left. Too blessed to look left. That's today's message. Too blessed to look left. Pastor Warren, what do you mean? As I stated, if it hasn't already happened, there's going to come a point of time where you are going to start looking left or right. And I say this figuratively and symbolically. Figuratively meaning that you're literally going to start looking left and right at people. Oh, she's cute, or he's attractive, or oh, he's popular, or she's real cool. You know, like you're going to start looking left. You're going to start being attracted to certain people. And that is okay. So I say that figuratively, you're going to start looking left and right. And because you already are doing so in friendships and in sports and just different things. Academically, you're already looking left and right. And I say this symbolically, right meaning you're going to look at the right people, and left meaning, you know, I don't want you to look at the wrong people. You know, don't go left, but go right. You know, don't make the wrong turn, make the right turn. And wrong is left, right, in this sense. And right is right. You know, so with this message, too blessed to look left, I'm going to give you the reasons first why you shouldn't look left, meaning towards the wrong people, or just because in this day and age, you know, you got all these relationship standards. And I'm not saying go get in a relationship or nothing like that, because, you know, maybe your parents are saying you can't date until a certain age or et cetera, et cetera. But regardless, you know, these are definitely necessary tools and practical tips, biblical tips as well, that you can have to know how to navigate through temptation, through, you know, urges, through just different things that you're going to experience growing up. If you already haven't already experienced, which I can pretty guarantee that you already are experiencing these things, right? In regards to just temptation and, you know, just looking left, looking right, and just, you know, being caught up in the hype of being in middle school and being in high school. We know how it goes. So literally, I'm going to be teaching you about how to not look left, And why you shouldn't. And then I'm going to be giving you biblical figures in the Bible that when they look left, nothing but wrong happened for them in their lives. So let's dive into it. Too blessed to look left. If you are watching me right now, I want you to say, too blessed to look left. Now turn your head right. You're too blessed to look left. Some of y'all need to be like this. We ain't looking left. We ain't looking left. We looking right. When your mom and dad call your name, you be like, and they over there to the left. You say, yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. Huh? I mean, yes. You know, but you don't look left. And they be like, how come you won't turn your head towards me? Pastor Warren said we don't look left. And you tell them about what you learned in today's sermon. So if you got to do a 180 or a 360, yes, ma'am. Okay. I hear you. Yes, ma'am. We'll do. You ain't looking left. But let's dive in the word of God. That's the first point. Don't settle for less. And I'm going to give you a synopsis of the story of Abraham and Sarah and Hagar. Now, Abraham was a blessed man of God, and God told Abraham, like, yeah, Abraham, I know you and your wife Sarah old, but I'm gonna still give y'all a kid. And back then in biblical times, anytime two, lack of better terms, anytime two old people would come together, you know, and be able to, you know, have a child, that means that this was a supernatural blessing from God. And God says that although you and your wife are old, Abraham, I'm going to give you all a child of old age, which means that y'all are blessed by me. And this is what happened in Genesis 16. I will kind of skim through the story. Basically, Sarah, Abraham's wife, wasn't able to conceive a child. And this made Sarah upset. So Sarah said to Abraham, the Lord has prevented me from having children. So go be with my servant and perhaps I can have children through her. And Abraham was like, oh, for real? Okay. And he agreed with Sarah's proposal. So Sarah, had Abraham and Hagar, the Egyptian servant, come together and they end up producing a child. So what happened was Sarah pretty much was like, God is not allowing me to produce a child. Why don't you just have a child with another woman? And I know that sounds funny, but things were different in Bible times. And so make a long story short, Abraham did that. And that wasn't what God wanted. Sarah settled for less. God had promised Sarah and Abraham, I will give you a child of old age. But Sarah got impatient and ended up had Abraham do his own thing. Abraham got impatient too. He guilty as well. But they both settled for less than what God wanted by having Abraham have a child with the servant woman that lived with them as well. And we have to not, you know, don't settle for less. A lot of times as children of God, it can be hard growing up with a sense of morals and standards that other people just don't have. You know, sometimes we can feel like outcasts because our friends can be in relationships, our friends just doing different things, but we have a different, you know, consciousness that guides us to say, I can't do what everybody else is doing. You know, I can't participate in what everybody else is participating in. And because of that, it could cause us to be like Sarah and say, you know, I'm missing out on something. Sarah felt like she was missing out on something. So she said, you know what? I'm a settle. Like, Abraham, just go be with her and then I can, you know, I can have children through her, basically. And that's not what God wanted. God doesn't want you to settle. God doesn't want you changing your mind. God doesn't want you trying to choose somebody who you know is going to tempt you and peer pressure you into doing things that you know that you shouldn't be doing. So a lot of times when we get older or even now, we have, you know, morals because we are children of God. And sometimes we feel like we are missing out because, we feel like we are missing out. But I want you to know that you don't have to settle. Keep your standard. You know, if someone crosses your line, don't step back and draw another one. A lot of times when people cross our line, we step back and draw another one. And then when they cross that line, we step back and draw another one. Don't step back and draw a line. Stand firm on your first line. Stand firm on who you are and stand firm on what you believe in. Because once you let somebody skate in your life, they literally roll bounce. And roll bounce is a term for that somebody can skate good. So once you let somebody skate, they roll bounce. And I don't know if you all know the game Limbo, but Limbo is a game where you have this bar and the person has to try to go under the bar. And once they do that, the bar is lowered again and they have to go under that bar again. And it's lower and lower and lower until, you know, the person can no longer go under the bar. It's like a game. A lot of us are letting people play Limbo. Never let anybody play Limbo in your life. Don't let people lower your bar, your standard of wanting to be the first person in your family to not succumb to teen pregnancy, wanting to remain pure in your family, wanting to focus on different things and not give in to temptations around you. You have to stay focused on that, right? So don't let people come into your life and play limbo with your life by lowering your bar and your standard, because eventually, guess what? People are not even gonna go under your standard. Eventually, if you keep letting people lower your standard, and this goes for friendships too, your standard is gonna hit the ground and people are no longer gonna go under your standard. They're gonna start walking all over you, on top of you. So don't you ever settle. The next point is don't be lovesick. Don't be lovesick. And what does lovesick mean? It means that you have fallen hard for somebody. It means that you're crushing so hard to the point you start doing things that are not of your norm. Or worse, maybe you like someone who you can't have. Maybe you like someone And you know you can't have them because it's like, eh, they do things that I know I don't or shouldn't do. That person is just not, eh, you know, or, you know, so it, love sickness, it ranges from a various things. Like either, like I said, either, you know, you like them, but you know you can't have them, you know, because their standards don't align with your standards. And, or maybe you, you know, like somebody and, you just know that you're not supposed to be with that person. So, don't be lovesick. And if we look at the Bible story of a man named Amnon, in Tamar, Amnon, was this guy who was David's son. David was the king of Israel, and Amnon was next in line to be king. However, he had a crush on a girl named Tamar, and this is what happened. Now, David's son Absalom had a beautiful sister named Tamar, and Amnon fell desperately in love with her. Amnon became so obsessed with Tamar that he became ill. He became so obsessed with her that he became ill. He was lovesick. Bro was sprung, to say the least. This dude really liked Tamar. And if you know the story goes on where he does something very mean, or not, I won't even say mean, of course, but he does something later in the story that he, that probably wasn't like himself. He went to the ends meet to try to be with her. He came out of himself to try to be with her. And that's what lovesick is. When you like somebody so much that you say, eh, I'm going to start trying to dress a certain way because I know it may help this person like me. I may start to wear shorter skirts. I may start posting pictures with my back turned to the camera to show more of myself in order to try to think this is what's going to get him to like me. Or I'm going to try to act tough and hang with the cool guys, skip class, because maybe this is going to get her to think, you know, to get her to like me. I'm going to try to do some things to try to fit in or blend in. If she likes tough guys, I'm going to try to get in a fight so that I can impress her. And a lot of us do this. Or he likes girls who are a little bit more revealing, so I'm going to, you know, reveal a little bit more of myself, you know, in the clothing I wear because I think that's what he likes. We do this. Don't be so lovesick that you come out of yourself. Don't do that. And that's what Amnon did. And ultimately, Amnon ended up leading to him dying. You know, and I'm not trying to say you go die or nothing like that. But what I am saying is that you can die spiritually to yourself. You can die to your morals. You know, you can kill your who you are on the inside. If it's not you, then stay true. If it don't feel right, then it's not right. And it's never, ever, ever, ever going to be right. You don't have to be so lovesick that you come out of yourself. If you got to come out of yourself to try to impress somebody else, that person is not for you. And that's on period. For real. The third point is don't ignore the signs as we get ready to close. Don't ignore the signs. Many of us know the story of Samson and Delilah. Samson was this big old strong LeBron James looking linebacker dude who was called to beat up a group of people called the Israelites, basically. And make a long story short, he had these, I believe, 7 locks, or one may even consider 7 braids. It was the source of his strength. God told Samson, bro, don't you ever cut your hair because your hair is the source of your strength, dude. So don't you cut your hair. So he had these long 7 locks and 7 braids. But when he got older, he started to like this girl named Delilah. This lady named Delilah. And Delilah was, she was just kind of a snake. You know, she just wasn't cool. She basically made a deal with the Philistines that, hey, if I can find a source of his strength, y'all will give me, she sold him out, then y'all gonna give me money, right? And basically, she kept asking Samson, what is the source of your strength? Although Samson knew his hair, he wasn't trying to tell her at first, but she just kept asking. Here it goes. It says, then Delilah pouted, how can you tell me you love me when you don't even share your secrets with me? Because she was faking. You made fun of me 3 times now. You still haven't told me what makes you so strong. He wasn't buying it, so she kept crying. And it says she tormented him with nagging day after day until he was sick of it. Finally, Samson shared with her, my hair has never been cut, girl, he confessed, for I was dedicated to God as a Nazarite from birth. And then it says Delilah realized that he had finally told her the truth. So she sent for the Philistine rulers, and basically they came in wanting smoke, and they basically arrested him. And she cut his hair while he was asleep. And that's when the Philistine army came in and arrested him. He tried to fight back. He was like, what's up? What's up? What's good? Let's throw hands. Let's throw hands. But what happened was his strength was gone because she cut his hair. And when he told her the truth about if he cuts his hair, then he loses his strength. But basically, I read just one passage of this. This happened at least, I believe, like 5 or 6 times where she, different days, she kept asking him, what is the source of your strength? What is the source of your strength? He would just give her funny answers. My toenails, my fingernails, just different goofy answers. And then that's when she started nagging him and nagging him and nagging him. He was like, my hair's never been cut. But he ignored the signs. This happened at least 6, 7 times. And that's the last point I'm giving you, is don't ignore the signs. If you start liking somebody or whatever, and you know, you find potential in them, they may be cute, but they may be a bad person. They may be good looking, but they may have a terrible attitude. They may be good looking, but they may gossip. They may be good looking, but they may just be bad for you overall. They may be good looking, but they may be a distraction. So the point I'm making is that don't ignore the signs. Delilah kept asking Samson, what is the source of your strength? What is the source of your strength? My question would be, why do you care to know? Why do you care to know? And then once he told her, she sold him out. So the thing is, people, when people show you who they are, believe them. The problem is, we like to say, oh no, that ain't you. That can't be you. Even after you hurt me, that can't be you. Even after you lied on me, that can't be you. Even after you spread that rumor about me, that ain't you. Even after you went on Instagram and Twitter tweeting about me and Instagramming about me, spreading rumors and lies about me, that can't be you. You're not who you're showing me to be. Like, no, when people show you who they are, you have to believe them. And think of it like this. Don't ignore the signs. So think about it like driving. When some of you are old enough to drive, or even when you're in the car with your parents, there's a stop sign. So you're supposed to stop because there are usually cars or pedestrians, you know, passing. If you don't stop, what happens? If you ignore the sign and don't stop, you hit a pedestrian. If you ignore the sign and don't stop, what? You go onto traffic and you ram into a car. Think of it like a stoplight, green, red, and yellow, right? The sign, that's a sign. It says go. That's a sign that also says slow down. It's a sign that also says stop. If you ignore the slow down sign and try to speed through the light, you can possibly hit somebody. If you ignore the red, you know, stoplight, you can go through the light and hit somebody, right? So the same thing works in our lives. If you ignore the signs, something in your life is going to hit something. It could be your self-esteem crashing into that person, you know, being just a bad person. It could be your I don't know. It could be something in your life. But the point is, when people show you who they are, believe them. And Delilah kept trying to pressure him into doing something that which was tell her what was the source of his strength. So if someone's showing you signs of them trying to pressure you into doing something, maybe they're trying to pressure you into not being pure. Maybe they're trying to pressure you to come over or you know, to leave your house, sneak out the house or whatever. Like, if someone's continuously doing that over and over again, or just really once, they're not for you. So the 3 points is, quick review: don't settle for less, don't be lovesick, and don't ignore the signs. Hope this message has blessed you. Shalom, Salem Youth.